Hello and welcome back to the AgostinhoZinga show with me, your host, AgostinhoZinga, and this is episode number 273. That's 273 of the AgostinhoZinga show. How you doing? How you feeling? Wherever you may be. Great, amazing, good to hear. If it's your first time checking out the show via YouTube, you know what to do. Smash that like, hit subscribe, and of course leave me a comment down below. And if you're listening via the podcast app, a 5-star review as well as a share will help to get the show far and wide out there into the atmosphere. And of course, if you want to support the podcast via Patreon, that's also more than welcome at patreon.com/AgostinhoZinga. That's patreon.com/AgostinhoZinga. You can find the description, the link below. Click on it. For little as $1, the equivalent of £1 per month, you get access to my entire Patreon as well as all the bonus episodes, all available on Patreon. So get on there, subscribe today and support the kid. Oh man, buzzing. Let's just get straight into it, because there's no point wasting any more time. Let's just get straight into it. England 2, Denmark 1. England are going to the finals. To the finals of Euro 2020 or Euro 2021, but regardless, right? It's maybe, finally, after all the hype, after all the false dawns, maybe it's finally coming home. Maybe finally, England are going to be able to claim a major international trophy since what? What was the last one we won? 1966? Many, many years in between then and now. Don't ask me to calculate. I'm not that smart. But Jesus Christ, we're finally in a final. I think this might be the first final in probably since 66. I'm not going to lie, right? I can't remember the last time England have been in an actual final. I remembered a few quarters, a few semis, but I can't remember a final. And we're facing Italy in the Euro final, having beaten Denmark 2-1. And what a great performance. Like, first of all, forget all the hype, but as a performance from a team, that's everything you ask for. England haven't even conceded a goal, I don't think, so far in Euros. The first goal that we concede is a direct free kick, which I don't think has been scored in the entirety of the Euros thus far. It's a pretty splendid goal, but then when you watch it on a replay, Pickford made a mistake. So if ever there was a game that would maybe show you what this England team are really about, this would be it. Pickford had to pick himself up. The defenders had to pick themselves up. The midfielders, everyone had to pick themselves up and find out a way to get back into the game and also to turn this result around. And you know, we kept on pushing, we kept on probing. We had probably the better chances, I'd say, even though Denmark did look quite dangerous on a break. I still thought overall England did look like they were putting together, or they were kind of, you know, causing Denmark more problems than the other way around. But I still did think that maybe even Denmark didn't really have any standout players, like really players that could hurt us individually. They still had what you'd feel like a very, which is probably why they got to the semi-finals in the most part, right? They're greater than the sum of their parts, right? As a team, they just function really well. And on the counter, the way that they will be able to interchange and knock the ball one or two passes and get it really quickly up the pitch was really good to watch, especially for, again, for a team that doesn't really have any real standout stars in their team. Everyone really kind of fits together really well. But for some reason, somehow Enger managed to dig deep, managed to weather the storm, managed to get a little bit of confidence going, managed to play the right balls, keep on stretching the pitch left and right, a lot of kind of really what it felt like at the time safe passing, but a lot of kind of confidence building for the midfielders, for the defenders to get onto the ball. Fullbacks were getting up a bit, maybe a bit too much in the first half, but for the most part it was a great team performance. And then just before half time we managed to get a goal, and that was again obviously his own goal by Simon Kjær from AC Milan. But prior to that, Sterling did have a pretty decent chance that he probably should have scored. He hit it directly at Kasper Schmeichel. And that's probably been one of kind of, that was more of a classic Sterling situation that you probably would have seen him do at Man City numerous times. But just the way that Man City play and the way that Pep has Man City playing, they generally end up creating so many chances that people forget the amount of chances that most of their strikers, people like, you know, Sterling included, miss on a game-by-game basis. So you're thinking to yourself, damn, you know, England are Man City. We're not going to create a ton of chances, you would imagine. Not probably to the same, you know, level of output as a Man City. But then as soon as he misses that chance, we get a second chance. Saka makes a great run, you know, off the last defender into the box. I forgot who cuts the ball into him. He ends up crossing the ball into the box, and then in the struggle to get back and clear his line, Simon Kjær inadvertently kind of hits the ball back into his net, and we're 1-1 just before half time, which is perfect. I guess, you know, from so far what you've seen in the Euros, especially when you're facing teams that have kind of gotten, we'll say a lucky break, but teams that have kind of got a goal fortuitously, you want to hit them back, you want to get back at them as soon as possible, preferably before the half has ended, so they don't start kind of hunkering down and defending for their lives, because the game would be completely different if we went into the second half 1-0 down. But the fact that we went 1-1, we kind of rewrote the wrongs, we started again, we reset, it allowed us to kind of come out in the second half and be a little bit more expressive, and we started the second half really well too. I felt like Gareth Southgate's substitutions were perfect. I felt like the team responded very well. I felt like even though Pickford had some really shaky moments, he managed to hold it together until the end of the match. Because maybe I'm being too pessimistic, but you always feel as if there's a mistake in an England team or there's going to be a lapse in concentration. But it feels like with this unit or this collection of players we have at the moment, if they do make a mistake, they seem to have the minerals and whatever else it is, in order to kind of gather themselves and kind of hold it together until the end of the half, until the end of the game. They seem to just be able to kind of just be able to hunker down and make it work. And I think other teams sometimes, you know, if they get like if there was a red card, if someone gave away a penalty, a free kick, suddenly the game will just slowly but surely unravel. But this team seems to be able to hold it together, and that is, I think, essentially what led us to victory. Because by and large, was the football amazing? Probably not. But in terms of the character and the determination, and more importantly, the luck that's needed to win a game like this, we got it. And the goal, the second goal, which was a penalty that Raheem Sterling won. Again, Raheem Sterling probably deserves an MVP award for what he's done for England during this tournament. He's really showed up and showed up, whatever that term is, right? And especially when you consider how disappointing of a Premier League campaign he's coming off the back of, right? Having been benched for the last few games of the season, and it's clearly looking like Pep Guardiola is basically planning for a future without Raheem Sterling as being one of the main components of his side going forward. He definitely did come into this tournament maybe thinking, maybe kind of, you know, there's a lot of hype around Sancho, a lot of kind of hype around Grealish, and people kind of forgot about what Sterling does for this England team, especially when he puts the England jersey on and he kind of reminded everybody. And he was instrumental in getting England over the line, and his driving runs, and, you know, even to win the penalty, he just decided to just pick up the ball and start running into the box, fishing for somebody to stick out their leg, hoping somebody kind of takes him down and we get a penalty. And luckily that ended up happening. The penalty itself, to be completely honest, I'm going to say it was a bit fortuitous. And at this level, if playing a semi-final at the Euros, if the referee isn't sure it's a penalty, you have to look at the screen, right? It surely has to go to VAR, and VAR may have to tell the referee to kind of double check it and make sure he's doubly sure. Because of, I know there's a clear and obvious error, fling, whatever it may be, but surely at this level, at this stage of the competition, the referee, or Denmark especially, deserve the referee just to kind of double check his decision, double check his work, and make sure, okay, cool, did I see what I saw? And if he did interpret, because I think some people are saying that maybe it wasn't the first foul, as Sterling is diving into the box, it's not the trip, it's actually the kind of shoulder or hip barge that he gets just as he's falling down. That's what the referee gave it as a penalty. But then if you're looking at the replay, you'd see that Sterling isn't in control of the ball after the first kind of trip or phantom trip. So to give a foul for the hip bump when he's not in control of the ball is a bit weird. But again, I think at this level of football, again, you need this kind of luck in order to kind of get through, in order to kind of give yourself a chance to win. And, you know, again, the luck is there, but you have to take the chances. We got a penalty, but there's no guarantee we're going to score it. And Harry Kane takes a pretty shit penalty for the most part. Kasper Schmeichel probably feels a bit disappointed that he saved it and it sort of like popped out in front instead of popping out to the side. He kind of tried to grab it and it kind of just popped off his stomach, and then inadvertently kind of ran back into Harry Kane's path, and then he didn't make any mistakes on the rebound. And then 2-1, you kind of felt as if the game was over. You kind of felt as if, again, outside of Damsgaard's amazing free kick, I don't think Denmark had any other real clear-cut chances on goal. I think they had a couple of shots. It literally says here, look at the stats. England's 20 shots to Denmark's 6. We had 10 shots on target, and Denmark had 3. So it obviously proves that there wasn't much of a goal for it. I think there was a couple of long range shots Denmark had in the first half, but they didn't really pull us apart and create any big chances. I think what's his face, the striker in the second half, had a pretty decent 1-2 exchange with Braithwaite. Dolberg, he had a pretty good 1-2 exchange with Braithwaite with outside the box. That was a pretty decent opening for them. But for the most part, as soon as England scored that second goal, you knew the game was completely over. And this England team is so mature now, is so together and knows what they're doing, that they were able to kind of hold onto the ball, if I'm not mistaken, in the second half of extra time for like 4 minutes without Denmark getting a sniff. We're able to kind of just, you know, kill the game off. There was occasions where Phil Foden was like screaming for people to play him into the box so he can score a goal, which is great to see. But I think the message got kind of through to him towards the end that, hey, we're just going to play this game out and just be professional and make no mistake that we're going to get through. And they did eventually. And it's just incredible to see an England team in a semi-final keeping the ball and kind of playing out the clock. It's like, wow, look what's happening. Look what's occurred. Again, props to Southgate. Again, I wasn't the biggest fan of his to begin with. I still probably think he's probably not a top level coach, but what he's been able to do with this group of players, the connection he has with the players, the fans, everything around this England team is completely different to other England teams that have come before it, even ones that are probably more individually talented. There's some sort of weird collectiveness around them and camaraderie and just love and appreciation, even for the players that are not playing. You just see that they're all kind of pulling in the same direction. I think that generally does come through on the pitch. The fans seem to be really up for it. Maybe it's partly due to COVID and the fact that we haven't been, you know, living our normal day-to-day lives for the past 16 months, but something's happening. I don't know what it is, but something is definitely happening and the players are responding. And again, it's up to the players still on the pitch. The fans can do what they want. Southgate can do what he wants, but the players have to go out there and perform. And so far, every time those players cross the line, no one's disappointing each other. They're not letting anyone down. Do you know what I mean? They're all trying to put their best foot forward. Yes, someone might make a mistake, but I don't see anybody hiding. I don't see anybody kind of, you know, thinking about their holidays. Sometimes you'd watch an England team, you watch them, you know, they're losing and they, you know, obviously aren't going to come back into the game. And you could quite clearly see some of them just like deciding, you know what, I'm not going to make any more mistakes. I don't want anyone to talk about me in the papers, or I'm already thinking about my holiday or whatever. They're completely tapped out of everything that's going on the pitch. And with these players, it seems that they sort of enjoy, they relish the responsibility, they relish the pressure, they relish everything about putting on that really heavy jersey, which is the England top. And, you know, you could see that on, you know, Phil Foden's face as Harry Kane is running off to celebrate, the joy, the jubilation, you know what I mean? He's just like, these guys proper enjoy playing for England. And it's been amazing to see, because you didn't really see that before. It was something that was, again, I think Rio Ferdinand spoke about before on his YouTube channel, about how tribal the England setup used to be. And, you know, due to club loyalty, certain players from certain teams wouldn't talk to each other and all this stuff. It was really weird. Now we've got, for some reason, we've got a real good collective spirit and it's helping us get us over the line. But still, the players, when the quality is needed on the day, they are definitely stepping up and you can only praise them. To talk about maybe some negatives, the only negatives, what I would say, the performance so far would be Pickford. Of course, he still looks shaky. He doesn't really kind of fill you with any sort of trust, but he doesn't necessarily fill you with any sort of calmness. He has a whole bag of nerves, and I think that does have a way of trickling into the defense. I think the couple of shaky moments that he had in the first and second half with some of his clearances generally made Maguire and Stones a bit nervy, but then I also think they weren't really getting adequate enough cover from Shaw and Kyle Walker either, so they were kind of being left exposed. That's only one slight thing I'd say. I would say maybe, who else was maybe a bit of a negative in the team overall? Kane first half was maybe a bit quiet, but again, he wasn't giving the ball too often. As soon as you started getting on the ball more in the second half and in extra time, you started to see his quality, his hold up play, winning of the free kicks. That was fairly good, and good link up play outside of the area here and there. Sterling, of course, was fantastic. What negative can I think of? The greedy substitution was a weird one, and then to sub him again in extra time, that was odd. Maybe Southgate should have thought a bit more about, you know, maybe bring on the defensive play in the first place and maybe not bringing on Greedy straight away. I don't really know, but that was a bit of a strange sub. But apart from that, there's not really much to kind of pick apart from. Again, it's just good to see an England team finally kind of doing what most fans think they can do, right? Especially given the run of games that we've had. It's no coincidence that the first kind of decent side that we face in the Euros in Denmark, they kind of gave us a bit of a worry, right? They scored first. They looked dangerous on the counter, blah, blah, blah. And I'm sure the games in Italy is going to be far tougher. And if there's one team that can resoundingly kind of trouble England, especially now in the final, it's definitely going to be Italy. I think Italy are strong, strong favourites. They look incredible. They've been tested by just about every type of team, and they've kind of passed the test with flying colours. So England are definitely going to have to be on their A game to win that. But given a run, you know, England would have really did themselves a disservice if they didn't get to the semi-finals at least. And now we've got here, and now we've got to a final. It's a cup competition. It's a one-off game. You never know what's going to happen. Again, Italy are the strong favourites. I've really enjoyed watching them play. I've watched basically every single match of theirs live. They're incredibly impressive. They have a strong bench. They play great football. Everyone's comfortable and technically proficient. They have a lot of tactical fluidity. They're, again, a well defensively drilled team. You know, that's to be expected. They have all the attacking flair to really hurt teams. Finishing ability, penalties they have no problem with. Like, there's a lot of tools that they have in their arsenal. But again, England shouldn't fear them. It's a one-off game. You never know what's going to happen. I'm just happy to see fans in the streets, people beeping their horns outside my flat, just being happy and excited, and just, you know, it's good to see people having a smile on their face considering how crappy the last 16 months or so have been. So again, England 2, Denmark 1, England through to the finals of Euro 2020, and wow, can't wait until Sunday, man. Can't wait until Sunday. What else do we have? Oh yeah, this is another bit of kind of a bit of a doom monger when it comes to COVID and stuff. This is courtesy of the Daily Mail. It said Sir Sage warns of freedom may only last for weeks amid the surging Delta cases. Boris Johnson tells Britons not to get demob happy when he relaxes almost all the rules on Big Bang July 19th reopening. It says here the return to normality could only last a few weeks amid the surge. The Prime Minister signaled a Big Bang end to lockdown on July 19th, saying it was now or never for a return to normality, as he acknowledged the pandemic was far from over and that daily COVID cases were up to 50% by Freedom Day in a fortnight, which is wild to think, in it, right? They're definitely just telling us, hey, you just go and handle it on your own, innit? Cases are up, but we're going to open the world up. It's a wild predicament to be in. He continues here, says, he claimed further delay would run the risk of trying to reopen in autumn or winter when the virus is at its edge. And in a downbeat assessment, Scientific Advisory Group of Emergency, SAGE, said that even if the hospitalizations and deaths remain low, there were major risk in letting cases surge. The group warned that should a variant concern arrive that threatened immunity, lockdown restrictions would need to be reimposed much longer. It needed released documents that advise on controlling the virus long term. Sage warned that the baseline measures may have to stay with sustained behavioral change necessary. And at a somber Downing Street press conference, Mr. Johnson warned against being demob happy and in the most of coronavirus restrictions on July 19th, and he toned down previous pledges that the path out of lockdown would be irreversible, with restrictions potentially returning. A final decision on whether the press ahead on the 19th will be taken at the start of next week, but seems almost certain to be approved. Mr. Johnson said that the vaccine program, it was continuing to be a success, and retaining restrictions would inevitably take a toll on people's lives and livelihoods, on people's health and mental health. Dropping the curbs will mean that the end of all legal limits on socializing, which will wreck family gatherings for 16 months, and the scrapping of social distancing rules have hobbled pubs and restaurants and arts. So the headline itself is fairly self-explanatory. And I think if you're somebody that lives in the UK, or regardless where you are in the world, especially when it comes to COVID and restrictions being lifted, there's not much we can do to fight against this sort of stuff, unfortunately, right? When these governments decide when and where we allow to go outdoors and stuff, it's annoying. It's really frustrating. You feel as if your rights are being stripped away from you. Your ability to move and earn money is somehow being hindered. Your health, your mental health is suffering along the way. But as it is, we're not going to do anything individually. We can't change stuff. The only thing that I can advise, especially if you're someone from the UK and you're reading stuff like this, is again super negative and it's going to make you feel a bit down, is that when the world does reopen, just try and make the best of it. however long that lasts. Hopefully it lasts forever, right? And we don't have to go back and it is irreversible. But if it lasts a few weeks, a couple of months, just enjoy it for as long as you can. Because I remember there was a period maybe last year when the gyms opened for a brief period and I didn't really go a couple of weeks, and then suddenly overnight they all closed again. You know, I was down for a very long time. Again, that's only gyms, right? That's nothing even that crazy. But again, knowing how much they've, the ability to go outdoors and go into a gym and work out and kind of, you know, be able to use that to help some of my kind of overall mood things and just get out of the house and all that stuff, like, it's played an important part of my life in general. So just imagine all the restrictions getting lifted and, you know, taking advantage of it, and then it being reintroduced again, and then you having no idea when your freedoms are going to get, you know, when you're going to be allowed to do those things again once again. So just take advantage of the time, take advantage of the restrictions being lifted, and just enjoy it for what it is in that moment. Again, I would much rather us have no restrictions until the end of time, but that isn't very likely, especially with Sage being these negative Nancys. And, you know, just there's a part of me that also wonders, like haven't the Sage people, but I guess they haven't, because you have to also think about it from a purely selfish point of view. Scientists in general haven't really been, no one's had, no one can probably name a leading scientist in their country before the start of COVID, right? But then suddenly they become, you know, one of the main people that you'd go to in order to kind of gain an understanding of this crazy virus that kind of came out of nowhere, right? That, you know, now we're learning maybe might have leaked out of a lab in Wuhan. Shock, surprise. But they haven't really had this level of exposure, right, or fame in any kind of way whatsoever. So it's not that, it's not that inconceivable to imagine why they're so hell-bent on reminding us of how dangerous it is to go outside and live our lives. Because by and large, once this, if this ever goes away, which it probably won't, we're probably gonna have to live with it in some way, shape or form, and unfortunately people are still going to die and still catch it and still be, you know, violently ill. But if it doesn't go away, or if it does go away, sorry, their relevancy and their kind of notoriety completely goes with it. So in order to remain, you know, part of the public conversation, they kind of have to constantly keep reminding us that if we step outdoors without a mask, that we might die. You know, if all the freedoms and the restrictions are lifted, that scores of people are going to die. It's just, that's what they have to do in order to keep themselves front and center of this issue, of this part of this global pandemic. And it is, again, it's macabre, it's maybe a bit cynical to say that sort of thing, but I generally think that's true. But there is a part of me that also thinks these people are humans like you and I. They have families themselves, they have their own interests that they kind of wanted to explore outside of being balls deep in viruses. Some of them, don't you think that they've, I wonder if they just haven't, they had enough, haven't they had enough of just staying indoors and being held under some kind of level of restrictions and not being able to freely move? Like, haven't they had enough themselves that they keep purposely putting forth these doom laden flipping assessments of what's going on going forward? Like, because what's the option? The other option is to what? Wait to vaccinate the entire population, or to offer it to the entire population and then reopen things. But there's no guarantee of that either, because the Palestine, is it Palestine? Or is it Israel they cite? I think it's Israel. Israel, who they cite, who supposedly has been able to offer all their citizens a vaccine or vaccinate everybody, it still didn't stop a certain variant from finding its way over to their country and completely, you know, flipping the script upside down. So there is no guarantee, there is no surefire way to get out of this. The only way you get out of it is just by deciding, hey, we're going to get out of this, and we're going to have the level of support that we can for people that obviously do get ill, and we just have to just go with it. Again, it's brutal to say, it's kind of weird to say it, it kind of sounds a bit callous and whatnot, but that's the situation that we're in. So once freedoms do get lifted, try and enjoy it for as much as you can, because there's no guarantee that these things are ever going to be lifted forever. There's always that kind of doom laden carrot being dangled over our heads, so just keep your head on a swivel in that one. Next on the list, what else we have here? Oh, we have this interesting news courtesy of The Guardian. It says Trump says he will sue social media giants over censorship, which makes complete sense, can be honest. Like, say what you want about the guy's presidency, obviously a car crash, right? Obviously the most, you know, easy to say, you know, easy to say. It's not a stretch to say that he is probably the most unpresidential president in the history of world, in the history of the world, let alone American politics. So it's no surprise that he's been able to kind of garner such a negative reaction. Like, it's interesting, right? Because he's like quite clearly extremely unlikable, but also he has that kind of quintessential ingredients that you need to be a superstar, right? To be a flipping a household name in some regard, right? You need to have an audience split 50-50, half of which love you and half of which hate your guts and want you to essentially die, right? And that's what essentially he was able to encapsulate. You don't really see that often with, I would say, political figures, like people actually wanting that person to, you know, catch a stray somewhere or whatever. Like, people really, especially if you're on the left, they really, really hated Trump. Like, everything he stood for, they just hated him, from his family. You know, Ivanka Trump was getting it left around center from people. The kid that's super lanky that doesn't speak was getting it. You know, what's her name? The wife was getting it too. Like, everyone attached to Trump was just completely hated. Like, you stood next to him, you endorsed him, you shook his hand, immediately people kind of had daggers for you and wanted you to drop dead and die. So yeah, obviously not the most unifying president of all time. But it also did seem weird to me from the outside perspective looking in, how somehow doesn't make sense, but it did seem weird to me from the outside looking in, how they just allowed all these tech platforms and these social media apps to just ban him from the public conversation whilst he was a sitting president. Fair enough, once he gets, you know, beaten in the elections, and then, you know, you can somehow maybe use that as a reason or as an explanation as to why you decided to deplatform him, blah, 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 blah. But imagine living in a world where all the social media apps and platforms decide collectively, behind closed doors, they don't obviously admit it, to one by one ban you from their platforms permanently, which is, in fact, especially nowadays, you're essentially removing that person from the public conversation. And you would imagine if you're somebody who's a politician, it's like it goes beyond the rules and remits of a social media platform, and it goes into kind of the benefit of the greater good, right, of the citizens in general, to have you have your voice on those platforms so you can speak directly to your constituents or whatever it may be, right? It just seems so strange that that was allowed, that that was kind of, everyone's fine with it because they hated the guy so much. It's just such a bizarre thing, and I don't think it's going to be ever repeated again, because again, I think, you know, he was just uniquely hateable in that way. But it did seem like a very foolhardy thing to do, because something like this was always going to come over the horizon. And there's one thing about Trump, he's going to be able to garner his base. He's going to be able to use his resources and networks in order to kind of run this court case all the way into the ground. Like, he's going to be relentless with this, because this is his one time to come back into the public conversation, to do the press runs, interviews and all that stuff. And if eventually this leads to a major overhaul into how tech platforms approach censorship and approach banning certain people, this is going to be a major win. But the only thing I'd say about this is a little bit bothersome would be, it's hard to really celebrate this if you're a Trump fan, because he was in power and he was in office and he did nothing to curb censorship, nothing to tackle it. He didn't really put up much of a fight when he was in, you know, when he was enjoying all the perks of it. And the moment it got taken away from him, and suddenly now he's becoming a free speech advocate. And I think it's a little bit too late, personally. I think, again, you know, especially with Biden in power, they've got who they wanted into the White House. Kamala's obviously next up if Biden becomes incapable of fulfilling his role as president, let's say. So I just don't see this going well for him, but I understand the frustration that must exist if you are a conservative living in the States. It must feel a little bit like there's one rule for us and one rule for them. Like, you can't get away. For, imagine a conservative saying what some of the people on the left wing say on Twitter and stuff about certain people, about whites in general and stuff. Imagine them saying that same thing. You would get absolutely you get ridiculed and you'd probably get banned forever. They don't really take too kindly to right-wing talk, right-wing figures and some of the more kind of extreme points of view that they have. And again, it's not really to say one's good or bad, but I just think if you're going to allow people to say, you know, all cops are bastards on social media, you have to also allow the opposite side of things. You know, I don't enjoy either extreme, but you have to allow it if you go that way down the tunnel. Best read the article itself is the following. Donald Trump, the former United States president, held a rambling press conference. I love how The Guardian says this. On Wednesday, to announce legal action against Facebook, Twitter, and Google, accusing the tech giants of censoring conservative voices. Trump was once an irrepressible agenda-setting force on social media, but in the wake of the 6th of January insurrection, he was banned from Twitter and suspended from Facebook until at least 2023 because of the risk of inciting further violence. We are asking the U.S. District Attorney, Southern District of Florida, to order immediate halt of social media companies illegal. Okay, let's actually play the video of what he actually said. Okay, it's actually quite funny how he pronounces the name Sundar Pichai, but let's hear what Trump has to say about the whole thing.
Today, in conjunction with the America First Policy Institute, I'm filing, as the lead class representative, a major class action lawsuit against the big tech giants, including Facebook, Google, and Twitter, as well as their CEOs, Mark Zuckerberg, Sundar Pichai, and Jack Dorsey. Three real nice guys.
Let's go that again. Let's do that again.
Mark Zuckerberg, Sundar Pichai, and Jack Dorsey.
But it's true, but think about it, right? Have you, like, it's the 6th of January, right? So it's obviously, it's been a long time. But he's essentially been removed from the public conversation. Like, you don't even hear what he's, you don't even know what he's thinking, what he's up, what he's kind of up to. Where he started that weird, what was it, like a live journal blog thing that he was doing, and I think he kind of sacked that off because of, you know, more than likely no one was checking it out, and it was probably costing too much money to keep up, and it was probably more beneficial to just put, if you're going to try to get yourself into the public conversation once again, this is probably the better route to go about it. Yes, it's going to cost you probably way more money, especially when you consider how many lawyers he's going to have dealing with this and how much they're going to be billing him per hour. They're going to be kind of rubbing their hands Birdman style to kind of make sure they cash in on that one. But yeah, man, like, censorship and deplatforming legitimately works because this guy is basically invisible. Like, if he died tomorrow, no one would, like, not die tomorrow, but he might as well be dead at this point. That's why he's not, you know, like, and for someone like himself, who obviously is obsessed with how he looks in the media and having a voice on social and opining on cultural topics and stuff, it must be hell on earth to be at home on a flipping burner account saying crazy stuff, but you're not garnering the same level of reaction because, you know, it's just not your same account as it was prior. It's not the same account that you had prior, of course. It continues to say that we're demanding an end to shadow banning, a stop to silencing, a stop to blacklisting, banishing, cancelling, that you know very well. Our case will prove that the censorship is unlawful, it's unconstitutional, and it's completely un-American. We all know that. We all know that very, very well. And so the complaints of Silicon Valley censorship have become a familiar talking point for the political right, but many of the popular, most popular personalities on sites such as Facebook, conservatives, okay, they're saying some of the popular conservatives, let's do it again, I'm trying, rushing here, I'm mumbling my words. It says here, complaints of Silicon Valley censorship have become a familiar talking point on the political right, but many of the most popular personalities on sites such as Facebook are conservatives, such as Dan Bongino, and Ben Shapiro. Ben Shapiro, I don't know who Bam Bongino is. So there is some point credence to it, but I just mean more so in terms of like the things people say and what you're allowed to do and what you're allowed to post. There's obviously a different criteria for banning and suspending that is given to people on the right and to, as opposed to what's going on the left. Now, you could say maybe it's because the things that people on the right talk about are probably a little bit more hot buttony, racier topics. So maybe there's a little bit more room for you to say the craziest. There's probably more chance of you saying crazy shit if you're somebody on the right, because of the talking points and the things that you basically feel passionate about. Who knows, like immigration and all that sort of things, you know, you can quite quickly upset a whole swath of people very, very fast if you start to get into all that kind of stuff. But by and large, it would be nice to live in a society where people just can just go free willy and just say what they want on social, without having, like, I'm all for, like, imagine if you've got loads of brand sponsorships and stuff and they don't maybe politically align with some of your beliefs if you're a conservative and they decide to drop you. I think that's cool. I don't think you can complain if you're sponsored by fucking Pepsi and you come out with some anti-immigration statement and they decide to pull the sponsorship from you. You know what the game is. It is what it is. It's unfortunate, but, you know, they're not doing it from a moral or ethical standpoint. They're just doing it more so to make sure that they protect their bottom dollar. But what I'm not a fan of is these platforms deciding who gets a voice and who can speak, who can say what, who can attack who. That's just not what I like. It's kind of selective in terms of allowing people to how they function on these platforms. So it'd just be nice if the platforms themselves could just be a bit more hands off. Obviously, allow people to post stuff that they want within reason. And then it's up to the audience, it's up to the listeners, up to the viewers, up to the people on those sites to decide what they want to amplify. Do you want to follow this person? Do you want to give that person a retweet? Do you want to amplify this person's voice? And then you go that way, because I just don't know. I just don't like the platform deciding it, because it feels a little bit like the music industry, where the music industry can blackball an artist and basically prevent you from making any headway in your career because they decided that you're a persona non grata. And I just don't think that is a fair way to go about things. And, you know, the kind of usual response or pushback would be like, oh, okay, cool, go and make your own thing. But they tried, didn't it? They tried to make it their own thing, didn't they? They've got Gab that got, you know, that went through its issues. Parler, of course, they had recently, the Conservatives, they tried to do that. And that, of course, then had its issues. And I think, didn't they take down the host site or whatever that was hosting Parler? And then it got taken down. And then the App Store said they wouldn't allow it back up until they changed certain things. Like, you can only go so far in doing your own thing before the powers that be, because unfortunately, the main kind of, you know, people that handle those things, such as Amazon and Google, they're obviously political leanings are swayed to a certain side, mostly left. But they also control the cloud kind of computing software stuff and, you know, hosting your site on certain places. You have to kind of communicate and kind of be in partnership with these people. Even I've heard some people on the right, you know, having their PayPals and whatnot being banned and Stripe accounts because of stuff they've said, you know, in terms of the politics that they kind of back and all that stuff. I just don't think that's the right way to go about things personally. Again, what's to say what's going to happen with this Trump case? Maybe he'll get thrown out in court, but I think he's got the necessary amount of clout, money, resources, network and all that stuff to really make a bit of a stink, and he might enact some change. But it just feels like it's a little bit too late. When he was in power, he should have probably put forth most of these kind of things. You would have had a lot more you had a lot more sway in maybe kind of convincing people of his argument. He might have had a lot more power, a lot more authority, and a lot more opportunity to actually win. But now it just feels like a little bit too late personally for me. But hey, you know, I don't blame the guy for trying to get back on social media, because once you're off it, especially when you're banned like the way he is, it probably just feels a little bit like you are kind of shouting into the void, isn't it? And that might explain why he probably isn't out here saying the most wildest shit, because there's no point saying it on your blog that no one reads, isn't it? You want to say it on the biggest platforms possible. I definitely understand where that's coming from. You've got this annoying article here from Deadline that says George R. R. Martin, ending of Game of Thrones was a different direction than I intended. I'm wondering, does it even matter what George R. Martin has to say anymore now if he's incapable of finishing the books? Do we care? Like, fair enough. Everyone gave him, what is it, D&D, Dan and David, a hard time for how poorly they finished Game of Thrones, but they tried their best. They followed the source material for the most part. Was it until like season 6 or 5 or something, right? It kind of followed, most of the books, you know, to the letter. And we got a really good show. We had some really incredible moments, some really great YouTube channels were spawned off the back of that, kind of talking about all the intricacies of the show and where it could lead. And then as the source material finished and they had to kind of rely on their own storytelling without George R. R. Martin's direction because he didn't finish the book shit, suddenly the show kind of unraveled and it became a complete mess. And now, you know, Game of Thrones was at one moment one of the most important cultural kind of television events of the week, and now, you know, people, whenever you mention it, it's just groans, right? No one's re-watching seasons of Game of Thrones unless you're watching again maybe the first 5 seasons or so. No one's buying any of the toys or merchandise or anything. It feels like at the moment, it's like most fans, you remember the beginning? So do you remember the maybe season 7 or 6 when everyone on the Free Folk was basically telling us, hey, I think leaking all the plot lines for the up-and-coming episodes, and people weren't believing it. No, it surely can't be this bad and whatever it may be. And they kept, like, basically the Free Folk was treated a bit more as, like, the detractors so much. Yeah, the kind of, you know, the bad eggs, the bad influences within the Game of Thrones fan base. And then as soon as the episode started to come out, we started to see how poorly the show was being written and, you know, the crazy directions it was going in and the crazy things that were happening in the episodes in general. Slowly but surely, we all turned into Free Folk. The Free Folk kind of subreddit became all Game of Thrones fans. And this is where we are. This is where we're at the moment. And again, for myself personally, I've kind of come around to Dan and Dave. Yeah, they fucked up the show and they made it unwatchable now in the future, but they did their best, especially given the fact that the person that is required to finish the books couldn't finish it in the time they were filming the series and still hasn't finished it now. Like, it's just insane. And now he's kind of popping out telling us, you know, about the different direction they intended. Ugh. Anyway, let's continue here. It says, author George R. R. Martin is still working on the next installment of his epic fantasy novels that became the base of the HBO Game of Thrones. He's still working. But he took time away from his labors to lament how the television version of his seemed to get away from his source material. The TV series ending has been widely condemned by fans, and Martin's slow output on his A Song of Fire and A Song of Ice and Fire story novels with The Winds of Winter and the next planned series has angered many eager for a proper resolution. Martin said that he was surprised that the television series outstripped his output. He says, when they began the TV series, I had 4 books already in print and the 5th one came out just as the series was starting in 2011. I had 5-book head start, and these are gigantic books, as you know, Martin told People in Chicago. I never thought that they would catch up to me, but they did. They caught up with me and passed me. Can't you then decide to maybe, you know, finish them then with that kind of, when you know, when that's being revealed to you? Why don't you just finish them, George? Come on, brother. While the show was on air, Martin had managed to publish just 1 volume of the series. Jesus Christ. Martin, so what's that? He managed to produce 1 volume in what? In 10 years? Or more than 10 years? In 12 years? Martin also noted that when the television series moved ahead of his source material, it felt like it was going in a somewhat different direction. So I'm still working on the book, but you'll see my ending when that comes out. When will it come out? HBO is a pretty good series of House of Dragon, set up with a 10 episode first season. It's better to have in 2022. Martin is again involved in the series' potential problems since he admitted the first series drew his attention away from writing. This guy, why doesn't he just come out and just say, I don't have it in him? Is that possible to say? Yeah, why didn't you just come out and just say, look, I don't have it in me anymore to finish the books? Because that's possible too, right? I'm sure, again, I'm no professional writer or anything, but I do know trying to write a book is pretty difficult. I would imagine so, especially under the pressure that he's at, and especially given the amount of time that's elapsed, right? The spark, the inspiration, the motivation, you know, it can kind of dwindle from time to time. So it isn't, you know, a stretch to say maybe he might have just lost the motivation to finish it, and now he feels like he's kind of being forced to finish it, and it doesn't necessarily something that he wants to do. But I would be perfectly fine if he just came out and say, hey, you know what, I don't really know how I'm gonna finish it. I can't really do it because I've got so many other projects on the go that I'm more passionate about. But in order to kind of wrap things up, I've put together a little cheat sheet or I don't know, something that can maybe tie all the storylines together a little bit in a nice little bow so the fans can have some sort of resolution. But in terms of maybe finishing all the books, he probably can't do it. Why don't you just come out and say that? I'll be perfectly fine with it. This sort of like honey dicking and, you know, dangling up the carrot every single year is just frustrating because we know he's never going to finish it. Because if he didn't finish it in the past, what, 10 or so years, what gives us any hope that he's going to finish it now? It just seems so bizarre that he's still playing these games, really. It just makes it weird. Unless he's actually in some sort of writer's block and he can't necessarily figure it out yet. But it just feels like to me, like, you know, he's clearly lost the motivation, or maybe he's other things that he's clearly more passionate about. And that's okay, you know. He's given us some pretty decent books again so far. A pretty decent, you know, couple of seasons of a really good TV show. You know, he's got a bunch of people into fantasy that probably would never give a shit about it. Like, he's done a lot. He could easily just come out and say, hey, this is basically where I end with this story. I'm going to start new things, so please don't ask me about this anymore. But here's the conclusion that you wanted. I'm going to go pursue my other projects. People will be angry, but at this point, you know, it's too far gone to really be outraged if he did throw his hands up and kind of admit defeat. But, you know, I don't know. Maybe it's odd as well, because maybe he does partly also enjoy the clout, the kind of clout, the fame that's attached to it, right? The constant questions, because no one's asking him about his new books that he's producing or the other TV shows that he's kind of advising or consulting, or no one gives a shit. And until they come out, people will watch them, but, you know, until then, we don't really care. So the only things that people are generally kind of stopping him on the street about, asking questions, is Game of Thrones. So maybe in his head, he doesn't want to let go of that as well. I don't really know. But regardless, whatever it is, it's annoying to see. What else do we have here? Let's move on. Oh, we've got this pretty decent article here from the BBC. It says, influencers react to Norway's photo edit law. Welcome, honesty, or a shortcut. So, it says the following, flat stomach, it says, when you're scrolling through photos on social media, it's sometimes hard to tell what's been edited. But would a disclaimer stating that the post had been filtered or modified help to improve a user's self-esteem? A new law in Norway is coming into force that will mean social media influencers can't post modified pictures without declaring that they've been modified. The rules will affect any paid posts across all social media platforms as part of an effort to reduce body pressure among young people, which is a bit of misleading, this thing. It's good news, don't get me wrong, but it's only across paid advertising. So if you're an influencer, you just want to throw up something, a little kind of thirst trap on your feed that isn't promoted or something, you're still going to be okay. It says, yeah, we need this law. Madeline Pedersen, 26, is an Instagram influencer from Moss in Norway. She tells BBC One Radio Newsbeat that it's about time the rules were changed and the hopes that the law will stop young people comparing themselves to unrealistic images. There are so many people that she says are insecure about their body or their face. I've struggled with body issues because of Instagram back in the day. She says the worst part is that I don't even know if other girls I looked up to did edit their pictures or not. That's why we all need the answers. We need this law. Madeline doesn't feel that she needs to edit the way that she looks in posts, which she says reached the audience of more than 90,000 people. She changes the light and colors and sharpens to get a better vibe, but says that she would never use the app to alter the way her face and body look. Cool and very commendable, but there is a part of me that sometimes, especially having seen what happened when Khloe Kardashian went through that issue, when she had that naked bikini picture of her leak and the backlash and the fallout from that and all that nonsense, and seeing all these other TikTok kids who are, you know, really young, maybe under the age of 27, right? The skin even isn't even sagging yet and they're already editing their pictures. Part of me maybe thinks, again, being a male and not really knowing the female brain too tough, it does feel like to me women by and large don't actually like looking like themselves. They want to alter their face, they want to alter their appearance, change how they look to the world, how they look through pictures on a somewhat daily, if not hourly, basis. It's just a fundamental part, it feels like, of the modern day woman's experience. There are some outliers that exist, women that are a bit more free with how they look, they purposely go out with no makeup, you know, they don't shave their legs, don't shave their armpits, all that sort of stuff, but they feel like a bit of a minority. I feel like most girls who like to get pretty, who like to look pretty, sorry, who like to dress up and stuff, don't mind filters, don't mind altering what they look like, maybe because maybe not even because they're unhappy with how they look. They just want to look hotter. It just comes down to pure vanity. And I think we maybe have to look at women maybe being more accountable to themselves as opposed to social media platforms, because for as much as this is a great law to put into place, especially for young kids, why don't girls themselves who are influencers voluntarily tell their audience that, hey, I did edit this picture? Why don't they do that? Why don't women in general admit to their cosmetic surgeries? Why does every woman say that she only got her nose or her tits done? I think I saw the other day a clip of one of the Kardashians on one of their reunion shows for the end of their TV program, and this is, she said something along the lines of, yeah, I've only got my nose done. It's like, you clearly haven't got only your nose done. Let's not lie. And even if that is the truth, part of the issue, especially with the Khloe Kardashian thing, from what I read, wasn't the fact that she edited the pictures, because she does. It was the fact that whenever someone comments on the fact that her face is different, she's thinking that it's mostly, or she's kind of purposely obfuscating or ignoring the fact that people aren't talking about your plastic surgery. They're talking about your kind of tendencies to keep editing your face with filters and stuff. But then you get annoyed when people post your normal picture and say that it's unfair beauty standards, when you're setting the unfair beauty standards yourself by not declaring that your edited, your heavily edited picture is clearly edited. So again, it's just like a lack of personal accountability, responsibility or ownership, laying it on the grounds again of the social media platforms. Like I mentioned in the article, it only affects paid advertising anyway. If you want to throw something up on your feed or your story, it's not gonna, you know, hint, you're not gonna need to divulge or let people know that you have a filter applied to your face or anything. And I don't know, it's just a bizarre thing. It's just very, very bizarre, the whole entire thing. I don't really understand it. I've always kind of never really got it, but I think now, looking back and looking at what's happened and what's occurred, it does feel like, to me, by and large, women just don't like looking like themselves. They don't want to look quote-unquote natural. They want to look edited, or they want to improve what they have or build upon what they have, regardless of what it is. They all have their own little kind of insecurities, and now they've been given a tool, especially with the smartphones, very easy to use tools to kind of drastically or subtly change how they look. They're going to go and use it, and they're going to use it until, you know, until the end of time. I just think it just is the way it is. I just think we've gone already, innit? The horses are already bolted. It's hard to kind of rein this thing in at the moment. It continues to say the requirements were passed as an amendment to the New Ways Marketing Act. The king will decide when they will come into effect. The government website says their aim is to help reduce pressure on society due to the idolized people in advertising. Among other things, a duty is introduced to mark reintroduced, retouched, sorry, or otherwise manipulated advertising when this means that the pressure, the person's body in advertisements deviates from the realities in terms of body shape, skin and skin size and skin. It will also cover filters like you might use on Snapchat, as well as digital alterations of things like body shape and size. It affects anyone who is posting a paid promotion on social media, including many influencers, actors and singers. Just imagine what kind of pressure it must, again, if pressure exists everywhere. I remember a friend of a friend who's from Brazil talking to us about how, you know, how much pressure there is around looking hot or being in a certain, or having a certain, not being hot, or being a certain size, whatever it may be in Brazil. And it mostly came from your family, especially if you're a young girl. It'd be like your extended family coming around your house, and the first thing they always comment on is how skinny you are, how big you are, you know, this and that, how this look makes you look good, da, 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 da. And those little micro compliments or whatever it may be called, or teardowns, would play a big role in your own self-confidence and how you viewed yourself. And that would drastically alter how somebody kind of interacted with the entire week. That might mean if someone said you're too fat, you might not eat the next couple of days. Like, it really sent people into a complete spiral. But just imagine what it must be like for a young kid in Norway, because, you know, you'd imagine most people associate Scandinavian girls with being a certain level of attractiveness. And then imagine you're a girl in Scandinavia who doesn't maybe adhere to the conventional norms of what an attractive Scandinavian girl looks like, when all your classmates do. And then the pressure surrounding that, you want to kind of live up to their beauty standards and the beauty standards of the world. And then there's a pressure that comes attached to it when you're growing up, you start getting into boys or girls, and there's a pressure to then become romantically or sexually viable to somebody you're into. Like, it's just it just seems so overwhelming. That's what it seems like to be like a girl that's from the ages of like 14 to 18 in Norway. Just imagine how much stress it must be. So again, it's probably a good thing that they're doing something, but it just feels like it's a little bit too late. It continues, it says, Madeline thinks the new requirements will mean influencers in Norway will be less likely to edit their pictures. She says they'll be too embarrassed to admit it, so they'll edit less as they should. She says, you're beautiful. You don't throw that away with some extra likes. That's some real life. That's not real life. Erin Christiansen, a 26-year-old influencer from Bergen, Norway, agrees the new law is a step in the right direction, but thinks it's not very well thought out. True. And again, I don't think people will be embarrassed. I think most people will try and get around it. I would imagine nowadays, if you want to be clever, you can probably still edit your picture via some sort of editing platform, screenshot it, and then make it look like you just took the picture naturally, right? I'm sure there's a way to get around it. So for sure, I don't think the embarrassment or shame thing will come into it. I think most girls or most people know if they can get away with something, and they're not going to be held accountable to it, then they're going to get away with it. I don't necessarily think that's an issue there. She says, to me, I continue to this, she says, to me, it seems more like a shortcut to fix a problem that won't really do any improvement. I agree with her. She continues, says, mental health issues are caused by so much more than edited photos, and another badge on advertisers' photos won't change how young girls and young boys truly feel. Agree with that one. A study by the UK MP, yeah, we don't care about the UK thing, but yeah, just imagine what the struggle it must be to be a kind of non-conventionally hot girl in Norway. And again, all these girls so far that I've seen on this page are fairly attractive, right? But imagine if you just look at slightly less attractive than them and you want to compete on social media, how difficult it must be. Man, pray for the kids out there in Norway. Pray for the kids out there in Norway. What to talk about? Oh yeah, let's talk about this. This is interesting, isn't it? This is courtesy of XXL, and I've been honestly fascinated by this because obviously I'm a huge Lil Uzi Vert fan, but this story is quite interesting when you juxtapose it with what happened with Tory Lanez and Megan Thee Stallion. So this is courtesy of XXL. It says, Lil Uzi Vert hospitalizes ex-girlfriend after allegedly punching her in the face multiple times, says her manager report. New information has come out what allegedly happened during an altercation between Lil Uzi Vert, St. John, and Uzi's former girlfriend Brittany Byrd in West Hollywood, California last week. Speaking exclusively to The Shade Room with an article published on July the 2nd, Brittany's manager, Brianna, whose last name was not reported, says that Uzi assaulted her client during a fit of rage, leaving Brittany Byrd hospitalized. Brianna claims that Byrd was having a lunch meeting with John and director James Samuel at the Dialogue Cafe in West Hollywood near Sunset Boulevard around 12 p.m. on Friday, when Uzi pulled up in a Cadillac SUV, confronted Byrd. The Philly rapper then allegedly punched Byrd in the face multiple times, pointed a gun at her chest before fleeing the scene, according to Brianna. St. John was not involved in this hustle, as previously believed. So, this is interesting in the juxtaposition with the Megan Thee Stallion and Tory Lanez thing, because what immediately happened, or the kind of backlash and the fallout from the Tory thing, was this idea that, you know, we need to protect black women, we need to believe women's accounts of violence and whatnot, da 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 da. And there was a collective effort which kind of succeeded if you look at the numbers and the fact that, you know, Tory still hasn't really been pushed on most of the platforms and all that sort of stuff. And Megan Thee Stallion has gone on to win numerous awards, probably some less warranted than the others. But in general, she's become an even bigger star than what she was prior to the altercation that they had. It seems like the concerted effort to cancel one person because of his alleged mistreatment of a female has worked, and it's obviously succeeded in the case of Tory. And then the kind of protection of Megan has kind of worked, but not so much, because it does feel like some people do kind of have a vendetta out for her and want to kind of see her fail because they're not really fans of her music or her personality. It doesn't really matter. But regardless, it did feel like at the time, the consensus around fans and around the media and press and stuff was mostly that, you know, Tory Lanez was bad, Megan was good. And we didn't really have much information to go from if you really kind of look at what happened. Obviously, we had the video of Megan kind of limping out of the SUV with her foot bleeding, which looked obviously really bad in terms of the optics. You had kind of Tory Lanez being laid out on the floor, handcuffed. You had the mugshot, da 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 da. But there wasn't really a lot of details as to what occurred. We didn't really know what happened between the video of Tory Lanez, Kylie Jenner, and Megan Thee Stallion in that kind of swimming pool, and then what occurred from that point to them kind of being stopped by the police on the street, and both of them kind of being arrested or being put into handcuffs. We didn't really get any answers what happened in between. But from this Lil Uzi Vert and Britney Byrd and St. John's incident, we've got pretty strong witness accounts, especially considering it was a cafe at 12 p.m. on a Wednesday, right, or something, right, in West Hollywood, on Sunset, or near Sunset Boulevard, so a pretty busy area, you would imagine. We've got multiple accounts that basically allege that Lil Uzi Vert not only hit Britney Byrd, he hit her several times and pulled out a gun on her, right, in broad daylight. And for the most part, no one seems to really care. Or is it mostly a thing of the fact that Uzi is signed to, supposedly he's managed by Roc Nation, I've heard, and you're seeing the difference in what happens when you kind of kiss the ring and you're maybe associated or aligned with a certain management company who has a lot more sway and a lot more pull in terms of media and press and what they report, with how the Lil Uzi Vert thing is being handled vis-a-vis the Tory Lanez. Because to be completely fair, what should have happened with Tory Lanez, what should have happened with Lil Uzi Vert, everyone should have just kind of waited until more evidence come out before everyone kind of cancelled or said you can't play this person, and if you support this person then you're this, you're that. Everyone should have kind of refrained from being super quick to point the finger and say, well, even though Megan Thee Stallion came out and said, yeah, he's the one that shot me, I think by and large the blacklisting and stuff should have been halted until more of the facts came out. In the same way, I think they're probably dealing with this Lil Uzi Vert thing. No one was really there. We've got different witness accounts, but, you know, eyewitness accounts can be a little bit dubious to rely on. But by and large, everyone's kind of, it feels like, waiting for more information to come out before they start to make a comment. But it just seems odd to me that so far we have far more damning information about what Lil Uzi Vert allegedly done vis-a-vis what Tory Lanez did. But for some reason, Tory Lanez is the one really struggling to kind of get the attention or the eyes of the general public, considering that he's been given no push whatsoever. And I think, you know, the last push that he did get given with the baby, or the last push that he did kind of manage to kind of capitalize on with that video, you know, racking up millions and millions of views, they quickly turned it into an issue because the baby was working with him, and that ended up, you know, affecting his relationship with Megan Thee Stallion, all that sort of stuff. Like, it just seems so interesting and so bizarre. But also, just in terms of just a purely artistic point, it's just insane to think that this little pint-sized rapper, this very amazing artist, probably one of the most versatile and interesting out of his kind of SoundCloud class or group or year, is such a kind of hard person to pin down. Because one moment he could be shoulder shuffling, looking quite effeminate and rapping about the most craziest of things really fast in this really unique style. The next moment he could be chasing Rich the Kid around in a Starbucks or a coffee shop somewhere. He could be allegedly, you know, running, what you call it? He could eventually be running up on his former girlfriend and rumored new boo and pulling out a gun on him. Like, he's such a conundrum, isn't it? You can't necessarily pin him down. What a unique artist in himself. But the story is wild. We don't really know exactly what occurred. Who knows what happened? Who knows what happened? Who knows what happened? But if there is one way to prove that you're definitely still in love with your ex-girlfriend, it's definitely running up on her and her alleged new fling and pulling a gun out on them and getting into a physical altercation in public, isn't it? That is one way to prove. Like, if there's one way you don't want to, because there is a thing with guys where you just don't want to show that you're hurt. You don't want to show that you're still attached, or you still have feelings for somebody, so you try and put this tough guy image on. But there's one way you want to really let people know that you are still madly in love with that person, is doing something like that. Like, he went crazy, innit? Allegedly, he went crazy. Like, imagine being that angry with somebody that you want to... First of all, hitting a girl, obviously, don't condone that stuff. But being angry enough to pull out a gun on somebody is like, that's some real passion. That's some real toxic love. That is some real toxic love. Like... I don't know. Next one. Oh, we got this. Yes. Great news for all my fellow techno fans and Berghain aficionados. Is back open. The Club Garden specifically is back open, and I'm excited, over the moon, jubilated. I think I actually spotted it over the weekend, yesterday. I kind of checked their website incrementally just here and there to see what new listings get popped up, especially considering all the open air parties that are happening this Friday and the following kind of weekends and stuff. You know, it's really going off over there in Berlin, so it kind of suited that to me. It was only a matter of time before they open up the garden. I've never actually been in the garden itself, if I'm completely honest. I think I've maybe seen it from the inside. There's a little smoking area bit near the stairwell where I think the garden may be, if I'm not mistaken. I've kind of seen that a few times here and there, but I've never actually been in it. So this is the opening night for the garden night. It's going to be on the 10th of July, so this Saturday. You've got Etap Kao, of course, Resident, Freddie K, and Paramida playing in the garden from, what is it, 1 p.m. I'm assuming till 10 p.m. I think that's where most of the nights in the garden are going to end. There's a few other great ones. There's a good Jansen night with Steffi and Virginia playing back to back, like loads of pretty decent ones going forward. But let's read the article itself, courtesy of RA. It says Bergen Garden is back. Bergen is reopening its garden this weekend, scheduled from 1 p.m. on Saturday and Sunday. The outdoor parties will be the first at the Berlin club in more than 9 months. So if it feels like long for time for me, being a being a foreigner and being a tourist, imagine what it must feel like for people that go there on a weekly basis, man. Crazy, innit? Confirmed acts include Freddie K, Paramida, Ben Clock, and Gabriel Wartank. The Bergen website also lists the club garden events for the following weekend. Highlights include Fidel, Gerd Janssen, Steffi, Batback of Virginia. To enter Bergen this weekend, attendees must show proof of vaccination or have tested negative in the past 24 hours. The website states that the mouth and nose must be covered on their own medical FFP mask in the queue, entrances and area, and entire club garden. The club will also only open in good weather. So there is a lot of restrictions obviously in place before you can obviously enter. It's probably not worth it to go, especially if you haven't been before and you're a foreigner, I guess. It's not probably worth the travel to go there just so you can go and party with a mask on outdoors. You probably might as well just do that at home or wherever you're at listening to this. But in terms of getting back into the swing of things, it definitely does mark the start of clubs slowly but surely reopening. I think softly but surely, that when the German restrictions get lifted one by one, you'll start seeing dancing being allowed indoors, and then clubs will start to reopen. But there's a lot of kind of beer garden-y, open airy kind of parties happening over the weekend, and it's just great to see, man. It's great to see that people are going to be able to dance again, you know, unplug from all the horrors of the world for a couple of hours or for a few hours and just kind of let loose. That's basically the name of the game, innit? And for myself, I'm thinking most likely to go from September onwards. I think that's probably the best time for me to go out and attack that sort of night. I think I'm probably the best to do that from then on. And I'm hoping by then the dance floors are reopened so that I can do my regular kind of yearly jaunt out there. Something that I've kind of done for the best part of what, maybe more than 5 to 6 years. I've kind of gone yearly. Before that, it was kind of like every other year. But, you know, considering how cheap the flights are, especially now, I just checked the other day, actually, a flight that I wanted to take from, like, you know, let's say like the Friday to the Monday, which is definitely a good time to go. You try and leave Friday night or Friday morning, try and get back Friday after Monday afternoon after you kind of left. Usually you take your luggage with you to Bergen on a Sunday and kind of leave straight away from there and go straight to the airport. It's an absolute mong show. When you get there, everyone's a zombie that's coming back to London because they've all been partying as well. All dressed in black, looking completely haggard. But I've seen flights, and usually I pay anywhere between, especially with the check-in luggage now, because most of the budget airlines don't include any sort of like free carry-on luggage, so you have to always pay for it. And usually it sets me back anywhere between like £100 to £200 all in, right, included with the luggage and shit. I checked recently and I saw max something of £100, 110. I saw another one go for like 80. The other day, there was another weird random date that I checked. It was like 55 with luggage included. Like, the prices are insane. So if you do want to go, it's probably beneficial wherever you want to go. If you want to go to Amsterdam, you're going to go to Georgia and other places. It's probably beneficial to try and get your flights booked in now, because I'm a big stickler for just getting the flights booked. I think the accommodation, again, certain cities like Barcelona, especially during like stuff like Primavera, it's probably beneficial to get the accommodation first, because the good accommodation, there's not a lot around, and you don't want to waste, you don't want to kind of take too long and then not have anything to choose from, and you have to go and stay in some, you know, some places far, far away from the location, from the venue that you're going to. But when it comes to going to do techno tourism in Europe, I just like to secure my flights. And if it comes, the day comes and I'm not really ongoing anymore, or things have changed, or especially with COVID now, the situation has changed in the country you want to go to, it doesn't necessarily feel like much of a blow if you've wasted, you know, under £100, under €100, as opposed to wasting over €100. So if I booked a ticket and it's like €86 or something, you know, it's okay, I can take the hit on that one. So I'm really looking forward to it. Again, the first parties are on what, this weekend coming up, as I mentioned before, with ETAP Kyle, Freddie K and Paramida, Saturday the 10th of July. So definitely, if you're in the area, go and check that out. It should be a good time. It should be a good time. Talking about time, how long have I used already? Ooh, hour and 10 minutes already there. I think that might be a good place to end, actually. Let's leave it there for now. So that was Jackson's English episode number 473. Thanks so much for tuning in, as per usual. It's been a pleasure to have your company. I've really enjoyed it. If it's your first time, again, make sure you smash that like, hit subscribe, leave a comment down below. If you listen via the podcast app, please share the show. That would be greatly appreciated. And of course, leave me a 5-star review and support via Patreon is welcome too. You can find all those links in the show notes descriptions. But until next time, see you very soon. Take care and be safe. Peace.